I'm pleased to introduce all of you to the moderator for our next session, my colleague and dear friend, Michael Wagner. Mike is an accomplished political science and mass communication scholar. You can read all about his many, many accomplishments in his biography in the program, but I also encourage you to follow Mike on Twitter. He is not only thoughtful tweeter, but thoughtful respondent, and one person who I think really uses that tool as an accountability measure. So without further ado, let me turn it over to Mike to introduce our panelists.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. This is so great to see such a terrific crowd here for the conference this year, and thanks to Katie and everyone at the Ethics Center for putting all of this together. So my name is Mike Wagner. I'm an associate professor here in the SJMC at UW-Madison. I'm affiliated in the Department of Political Science and the La Follette School of Public Affairs as well. And it's my great pleasure to moderate our panel, Blind Beliefs, Conspiracies, Hoaxes, and Disinformation. We have a terrific slate of panelists. We'll talk with each other for about 40, 45 minutes, and then we'll take questions from those of you in the audience. For the live streamers out there, I'll look at my phone every so often. If you have any questions, you can use the hashtag UWEthics, and I'll try to get to some of those as well. Our first panelist is my friend, Joanne Miller, an associate professor in the Department of Political Science at the University of Minnesota. She also has appointments in the Psychology Department and the School of Journalism and Mass Communication at the U, which I can say is a native Minnesotan. Her work, which has been funded by the National Science Foundation and Pew Charitable Trust, centers on psychological underpinnings of political attitudes and mass behavior. She is a superstar researcher, an outstanding teacher, and a terrific mentor. Her most recent research landed her on this panel as it investigates the antecedents of conspiracy beliefs. So perfect for today. And that work in particular has been featured in the New York Times, Salon, the Washington Post, the Atlantic. If you Google Joanne Miller conspiracy, you'll find lots of great articles about her stuff. Maybe we can start some conspiracies about her today as well. So welcome, Professor Miller. Our second panelist is one of Wisconsin's best-known voices, both in the literal and figurative sense. Charlie Sykes was one of Wisconsin's top-rated and most influential conservative talk show hosts before stepping down from his show at the end of last year. He's currently an MSNBC contributor and a co-host of the national public radio show Indivisible. He's been widely credited with aiding the rise of Governor Scott Walker here in Wisconsin, and Speaker Paul Ryan is an outspoken critic of the Trump administration and of what he calls the conservative alternative reality media. Sykes is the author of 8 books, including A Nation of Victims, Prof Scam, and Fail You, the letter U, The False Promise of Higher Education. He's currently working on a book titled How the Right Lost Its Mind, which will be published by St. Martin's Press in October. He's also the founder and editor-in-chief of the website RightWisconsin and a senior fellow at the Wisconsin Policy Research Institute. We're delighted to have Mr. Sykes here today to share his views. Our third panelist is my friend and former colleague, I'm sad to say former, but she's back, which is great, Deborah Blum. She's the director of the Knight Science Journalism Program at MIT. I'm not familiar with that institution. Blum is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist, the author of 5 books, including The Poisoner's Handbook, and publisher of the digital science magazine Undark, which is really terrific and I cannot recommend enough. In addition to her book work, she's written for The New York Times, The Washington Post, The Wall Street Journal, Time, Discover, Scientific American. Before leaving us for MIT in 2015, she was the Helen Firstbrook Franklin Professor of Journalism at the University of Wisconsin-Madison. It's wonderful to have Deb Blum back on campus. So with our kind of title and topic today, I was thinking a bit about another person we had tried to get on our panel who couldn't make it, Chris Mooney, who often reports for Mother Jones and other outlets now, but wrote a fairly widely circulated piece called The Science of Why We Don't Believe Science in Mother Jones. And it opened with this story about a psychologist who wanted to study what happens when it's revealed that a hoax is a hoax. What happens when a group who believed something was going to happen doesn't happen. And this group was called the Seekers in 1954 in the Chicago area. And the Seekers were led by a Dianetics devotee who believed that she was communicating with someone named Sananda, who was kind of the astral incarnation of Jesus. And the idea was that the world was going to come to an end, or at least the United States was going to open up and get swallowed back into the sea. And the Seekers were to be ready to be taken up by the aliens to be saved for believing in the prophecy. So a professor at Stanford, Leon Festinger, thought, I want to be there when they're not taken up by the aliens and the planet doesn't swallow itself into the sea. What happens when that happens? And when it happened, they quickly reasoned, oh, well, our devotion to the prophecy has saved us all. So instead of seeing the hoax to be a hoax, they found a way to engage in what political scientists, psychologists, and others call motivated reasoning, finding a way to keep believing what you wanted to believe, even in the face of evidence that you're wrong. And just kind of with that as a backdrop, and with, you know, one of the nation's preeminent scholars on conspiracy theories sitting right to my left, I'd like to start with Joanne Miller. And what are some of the reasons people believe in conspiracy theories?
Great. Thanks, Mike, and thanks for inviting me today. This has been a fantastic day so far. So first thing I'll say is that conspiracy theories are not solely the domain of tinfoil hat wearing middle-aged men living in their parents' basements. A recent study found that at least 50% of the American public believes at least one conspiracy theory. In addition to motivated reasoning, which Lucas also elaborated a bit this morning, I want to say something a little bit more. There's even a more fundamental, if there can be anything more fundamental than motivated reasoning, something more fundamental about why we believe conspiracy theories, or at one point in our life have believed a conspiracy theory. And it has to do with our need to reduce anxiety and reduce uncertainty and the anxiety that comes along with uncertainty. One of the interesting findings in the social science literature about conspiracy theories is that people who live in New York and New Jersey were more likely to believe conspiracy theories surrounding the 9/11 attacks than people who lived further away from the attacks. There's something key about the uncertainty and the anxiety that uncertainty causes that makes people seek answers. And it's kind of ironic that conspiracy theories are an answer that calms people, okay? Because conspiracy theories are, in a sense, an unknown. But by tying things up in kind of this neat conspiratorial bow, we can reassure ourselves that it wasn't, in fact, random. That there was some, it may be secret, but there was some machinations here that caused this to happen. And that belief actually does reduce some of that anxiety and some of the uncertainty. And as a purely sort of psychological process and that sort of general need, conspiracy theories do serve that purpose, and we can think of them as a version of a coping mechanism. Now, that's not to say that they don't oftentimes or sometimes have very deleterious consequences, so in normalizing the belief, I don't want to normalize the effects, but I think it is important to recognize that these aren't paranoid extremists who are the sole believers.
Thank you. So I wanted to kind of go from a research view of this to kind of experiencing on the ground, as Charlie Sykes did during the primary and general election season when he was hosting his morning talk radio show. And you've done a number of major interviews over the last several months, kind of culminating maybe in a piece you wrote for the New York Times, where you'd noted that you'd noticed an uptick in people that you had known to be thoughtful listeners of your program forwarding you messages that Barack Obama was a secret Muslim or Hillary Clinton was running that secret sex ring out of a pizza parlor in Washington, D.C. And what do you think has been driving that kind of behavior? And why do you think it was revealing itself now in your domain of talk radio after you maybe hadn't noticed as much of that in earlier incarnations of your work?
That's an excellent question, because these things are not new. You've had the paranoid style of American politics been around for a long time. By the way, if you have not read Richard Hofstadter's essay from 1964 on the paranoid style, you ought to go back and read it and realize this has been around for a while. But so it's not new, but a lot of it is extremely new. What you're seeing now is the supercharging of all of this. In fact, there's been a number of studies out. I see the Oxford University just came out with a study that found that nearly a quarter of the web content shared by Twitter users in Michigan during the last 10 days of the election was just completely false news. The volume was much greater. You'd created what I've called the alternative reality silo. So what's happened is, well, there's like, I think maybe four or five major factors here. Number one, you actually have the growth of institutions like Breitbart, Gateway, this entire echo chamber that really created its own narrative, its own set of facts, its own reality. They were able to disseminate news, very, very rapidly, and frankly, often irresponsibly. And this was, of course, very, very well funded. I heard a question in the previous section about the Koch brothers. You guys need to get with the program. The Mercers are a much bigger problem than the Koch brothers these days. And they funded a lot of things like Breitbart. Beyond that, though, the reality is that Donald Trump himself has weaponized these conspiracy theories. He has embraced this. He has reached out. It's an old story that there are the paranoid extremists out there, but now we have a president of the United States who will actually cite them, read them, that he is comfortable in this world. When you actually have the president of the United States citing things from the National Enquirer or talking with InfoWars, in the book that I'm writing, How the Right Lost Its Mind, I was trying to determine what the exact moment was when the Drudge Report began linking to InfoWars and Alex Jones. Alex Jones is one of the darker denizens of the fever swamps, who believes that 9/11 was an inside job, who believes that Sandy Hook was fake. Donald Trump goes on his show. Donald Trump calls him after the election, thanks him for his help. InfoWars right now has more web traffic than the Chicago Tribune website. So what's happened is that a lot of this stuff has been mainstream. I'm just going to leave it out there what the role possibly of the Russian bots happened to be. There's something going on there as well. And then, of course, the reality is that I think what you were asking me about is that we have an audience and we have an electorate that is willing to believe it because they are in this alternative reality silo. And it's very, very hard to knock it down. It's very, very hard to basically say, that story is not true, and here is the source, if that source comes from outside of the silo, outside of the bubble. Now, whether it's because we have people who are illiterate about the media, whether people are more credulous than they were before, maybe our lack of civics education has caught up with us, or maybe it's because, as you pointed out, the confirmation bias, that people, American politics now is very, very tribal. And the tribal, each tribe creates its own narrative. And people want to believe the narrative. And they only require a little bit of evidence for them to believe it. So there's two things. Why was there this massive explosion of false information, hoaxes, conspiracy theories? But then why were so many Americans willing to believe it? I actually think that what's ever happened this year and last year, it's about to get a lot worse. I think that a lot of the worst actors have been empowered and enabled, and that all of the trends that we're going to talk about are actually being supercharged.
Thank you. So I'd like to ask a question, too, to kick things off to Deborah Blum. And I think there are a lot of things in both the first two answers to unpack, and we'll get to them in a few moments. But just to give everybody a chance to kind of say something off the top, both Joanne Miller and Charlie Sykes were talking a little bit about the audience side of this, or the purveyors of conspiracy theories in the not mainstream media side of this. What about journalists who are outside of that bubble that Charlie was talking about, and are people who are like you, who write in the New York Times and the Washington Post and appear on Frontline or other kinds of programs? What are these journalists doing, if anything, that are allowing these conspiracy theories to persist? Are they not reporting on them in ways that effectively knock them down? That sort of thing.
Well, all the best lies have an element of truth. And the fact is there are actually out there, if you look for them, conspiracies. It's not that they don't exist. And so you have to at least acknowledge, going back into history, that there have been conspiracies, and it's that awareness that allows people to then speculate and build fantasy conspiracies.
Deb, can I get you just a little closer to the mic for the live
stream?
Yeah,
can you guys hear me okay? Okay. So, but the other part of it is that there are constructs of journalism that I think allows us to kind of fall in some of the pits. And one of them is, and we certainly have talked about this a great deal in science writing, the long time argument that good journalism would be objective. And so that there were always two sides to every story. And that we had to present that both fairly and equally. And certainly this came up repeatedly as a criticism during the press coverage of the election, right? That there was a false equivalency to the way we covered the two candidates in our efforts to. You see this, and I'm going to talk about my own sort of experience, which is climate change. I'm a science reporter. This hugely affected, I think, and I would mark it down as a failure of the press, the way we reported climate change was the need to always say that there were two sides. So that even if you knew as a journalist, and I'll go back and say, I was a longtime science reporter in California, had to do the winter weather forecast every year because water is critical in California in the winter. About 1989 or 90, I realized that the bench meteorologists were factoring human-induced climate change into their forecast. And it wasn't like they were going out publicly and saying it. It just went into their equations as they were trying to forecast. And so about 1989 or 90, I started believing in climate change. Because if you're a science reporter, it's bench scientists and mechanisms that are persuasive. So, but every time I wrote about climate change, I would have to tell the other side, right? And so one of the things where I think we have fed into a lot of these problems is we've given more power to false narratives by acting as if there's some credibility to them. We've given more power to critics, even critics who aren't part of the scientific consensus, by acting as if their point of view is equal to the scientific consensus. And I think that plays out across politics. And I think that if you look at sort of, I'm going to pick other hot button areas of science, the anti-vax movement, or some of the GMO reporting, you're going to find exactly the same thing. So in that sense, I think that we have got to do a lot better at doing our homework, establishing what the real story it is, and telling it effectively.
So that's kind of a, you know, the climate change is sort of a classic example, I think, that science reporters and academics use. A lot of research that tries to figure out why do people believe things that aren't true use climate change as an example on the right, and usually vaccines as an example on the left. But a lot of science reporting is less cut and dried in terms of what scientists believe about the truth. And a lot of what I see in people's reactions to science reporting is, well, today I read that eggs are good for me, and tomorrow I'll read that they're bad, and today coffee will keep me alive for 5 years, and tomorrow it'll kill me if I drink too much. And what is it that journalists need to think more carefully about as they cover these issues to make it harder for audiences just to say, well, a pox on everything, it's all, you know, the right and the left are both liars, scientists don't know what they're talking about. There's too much back and forth for people who are living their lives and doing their laundry and taking their kids to school to make sense of all of this stuff.
You know, one of the problems, the other ongoing problems in the way we cover science is that science is a process. And it's a natural, it's a process of inquiry. You're going to study, you're going to go backwards and forwards on things as you try to figure out what's real. But journalism is event-driven, so that we tend, every time that one of these studies happens, to report it as if it's somehow an end result. So, you know, the example you gave, coffee is good for you, coffee is bad for you. I like all the coffee is good for you stuff.
Me too.
I like all the alcohol is good for you stuff.
Me too.
I deeply resent, you know, the contradiction. But it's basically, that's the normal logical part of science. And so we have a kind of cultural conflict between the way journalism tends to work and the way science works. And we need to do a much better job, I think. Again, you're going to hear the word context a lot, of putting any individual finding into some kind of context and putting it into the context of the whole arc of that inquiry. And the digital age in report, I publish a digital publication. I see it as one of the really exciting new changes in journalism. But because it's relentless in its need for information, we see more and more sort of quick hit single study stories. And just to tell you guys as a big red flag, if you see a single study story, you should discount it, right? One study doesn't mean anything. unless it's put in context. And one study in which the only expert is quoted is the scientist who's telling you that it's the greatest discovery ever made, and by the way, he needs more funding, or she, is meaningless again. And so when we talk about media literacy, I would love to see us talk a little bit more about science literacy, science media literacy. The kind of thing that I would roll my eyes at is the kind of thing I want you to roll your eyes at, basically.
Can I just jump in real quick and just say I would add to that that not just the skepticism of the single study stories, but also the skepticism of the reporting of studies that have not yet been peer reviewed. We're seeing a rush, and I'm guilty of it as well. Of course, I think my work is right, so I'm not actually guilty of this, but of either tweeting or blogging about findings that have not yet been peer reviewed. And we're all encouraged now as scholars to get out there in the public and talk about our work. But there's a danger in then the reporting of those findings that aren't yet peer reviewed that are absolutely not put into full context, at least not, especially not even in the writing up of that single piece.
I agree, and I don't mean to take us down, my geeky science pathway, but I'll make one
That's why you're
point.
Here.
But I always go that way anyway. It's a tricky balance when you're a science reporter today because there's a couple of things going on. Science as an institution, I think, feels very much under attack in the current administration. And as you probably know, partly in response to that, there's a March for Science on April 22nd. The largest part of that will be in D.C., but it's going to be echoing around the country. Just talked to some friends of mine in Denmark, and they're going to March for Science on April 22nd. This leads to something that I think is a very tricky balancing act, which is that people start to see scientists as an interest group and a political interest group, right? And I actually had a conversation a couple weeks ago with the head of the American Association for Advancement of Science. And I said to him, are you going to march? Are you worried about this? And he said, I've already got my T-shirt, so I'll be out there. But we do see in this age, this kind of questioning of scientists as objective sources in the same way that we see it with the media. And that makes it sometimes very tricky for us in the way we tell our stories.
It's interesting. Dietram Scheufele, who's a professor of science communication here in the life science communication department at UW-Madison, has said recently, I think in an interview or a blog, that it's a bad idea for scientists to go on this march. It politicizes their work. It opens them up to different kinds of criticism that are outside the process of their own work. And, thinking about how that critique happens, I want to get back to Charlie and that same New York Times piece I referred to earlier. You wrote in there, quote, "We destroyed our own immunity to fake news while empowering the worst and most reckless voices on the right," quote. Since you became a vocal critic of Donald Trump during his candidacy and his presidency, some liberals have praised you for, taking on your own side, your own party anyway, in this particular case. Some conservatives have praised you for standing up for more traditional Republican principles.
Not all of them.
Some liberals say, oh, well, now that Charlie Sykes says mean things about Donald Trump, liberal UW-Madison will have him on a panel. Where was he on a panel for the first 22 years of his radio show when he was saying other things, right? And so there's these critiques going back and forth. And how much of this is... what we're talking about today? How much of this is the consequence of talk radio saying we can't trust the mainstream news media, and the reason we have talk radio is because the mainstream news media is not trustworthy and slant their news? Is this part of the culprit?
Oh, absolutely, and that's that was the point of the article. But also there's a push and a pull, and what you didn't quote was where I basically said, look, for the last 40 or 50 years there have been critiques of the mainstream media. And I would suggest that this would be a great time. I understand why the media, engages in self-celebration. A little introspection would go a long way, because we have this crisis of credibility right now. This whole thing turns on the question of, people want to know, who can I believe? You have an alternative media that rose up because there were questions about the credibility and the reliability of the mainstream media. The mainstream media largely reacted to that by saying, nothing to see here. We don't need to pay attention. years and years of polls showing greater questioning of the credibility. And the reality is that I think there was a certain arrogance about all of this. But yes, there's the push and the pull. There was a huge effort on the part. Look, going back to the 1960s, actually to the 1950s, you know, conservatives have been railing about the bias of the mainstream media. One of the reasons why alternative media was successful was because there was an audience, there was a market for it, people who felt that, okay, for the first time, people are talking to me with respect. They're talking about the issues that I care about. They are not treating me with disdain and with contempt. I would like to say that folks in the mainstream media responded by saying, hey, how can we become more intellectually diverse? They didn't. Generally, when there's a discussion of diversity, it's not intellectual diversity. But there's no question about it. At some point, we, and I was certainly part of this, we did destroy the immune system of people to fake news. And we now have, I mean, you know, I think there's some great reporting going on. What really, really struck me during the campaign, for example, the Washington Post, I think probably should get a Pulitzer Prize for its investigative work into Donald Trump's charities. I'm just picking that out as an example, David Fahrenthold. But I have to tell you that half the country never heard it.
Right.
It does not penetrate. You can do the best reporting in the world, but unless you can find a way to restore that credibility, break through that chrysalis somehow, it won't even register. So I had David Fahrenthold on my show, and the audience reaction was, this is fantastic, this is really interesting, this is troubling, I'd never heard it before. And I'm guessing that I was probably the only conservative talk show host in America that had David Fahrenthold on the show talking about what a fraud Donald Trump was. So we are, you know, talking about what do you do if, in fact, you have a huge section of the electorate that, frankly, believes what it wants to believe and is accepting some things that are not true and then are basically totally oblivious to the good, legitimate reporting that's going on.
So, Joanne, is knowledge an elixir here to the belief in conspiracy theory? So if there are people who will listen to a radio show and say, gosh, it's nice to hear from David Fahrenthold on this show, and I had no idea that he had kept this list of all of the charities Donald Trump had claimed to give something to, or might have maybe even had the opportunity to give something to, and I called them all, and virtually none of them said they ever received a check from Donald Trump. You know, it's knowledgeable people, typically, who are reading newspapers, as compared to those who don't. Is knowledge a silver bullet here to make it so we don't believe in conspiracy theories?
No, just no. In fact, knowledge exacerbates these phenomena. Motivated reasoning as a phenomenon is when you're believing things that help to bolster your own viewpoints, your own beliefs, your own predispositions. It turns out that people who know a lot are better able to do that, and they're more motivated to do it. One of the reasons they know a lot is because they care, and they care, and therefore they care about their own positions, they care about their beliefs, they also think they know more than they know, and as a result, they're more motivated to defend those beliefs. And so, unfortunately, knowledge isn't a panacea. And in fact, is the reverse. It actually does exacerbate. It's sad. I can tell you what the panacea is, and there's also a sad story here because the panacea is trust. What I find in my work is that the people who are most likely to believe conspiracy theories, in some of my work, and maybe we'll get to this. It's been conservatives who are more likely to believe than liberals, or Republicans more likely to believe in Democrats. I actually don't think that's because conservatives are more prone to this in general, and I'd like to get to that at some point. But it's the high knowledge, low trust folks. Knowledge turns on conspiracy beliefs, trust turns it off. If you trust the world, it's harder to believe that people are engaging in secret plots to undermine the world. And I say that there's a good news and a bad news here because the bad news part is that we're in probably the lowest level of trust, not just in the media, in political institutions, trust in people in general, than we've seen in a while. And so don't ask me how to fix that. But I can tell you if we could fix it, that's more of a panacea than knowledge is.
Could I follow up and ask a question?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Jonathan Haidt has a great book about the righteous mind, and I want to know whether you agree with this, where basically, and this is the kind of the bad news, is that the human reasoning is not really designed to determine what is true. It actually works to, again, to confirm your bias or to strengthen your bonds to your tribe. That, you know, the evolutionary thing is that we learn so that because we don't want to be on the outside of the tribe. So as a result of that, what you have is you have this tribal mentality. And he quotes one study where he says that it's the can I believe something and must I believe something, where if you want to believe something, you say, can I believe it? And you only need one piece of evidence that you can believe it. The must believe it is, look, if I don't want to believe something, I don't want to believe that the Russians actually, you know, colluded with Donald Trump, so I need one piece of evidence. I need just one thing from Gateway Pundit or Drudge Report to knock it down. Do you agree with that analysis, that we're not generally basically truth seekers? Because if you would have asked me a year ago, I would have said, of course we're all interested in truth. We are all seeking truth, right? But no.
No, I definitely agree. And that's one. I'd like to echo something that Lucas said in the last session. I would like, as some panelists would like to wipe the phrase fake news off the planet, I would like to wipe the phrase post-truth era off the planet, because it assumes that there was a truth era. And I think what Jonathan Haidt's work and evolutionary psychologists and my work and others show is that's not the case, that we are more hardwired to believe things that support our tribe than we are. And we're more, like you said, it only takes one piece of information to believe, and one piece of information to not believe. And that...
That explains a lot.
It's sad, but it's my work is very sad. but I think that's really true, and I think that makes it's difficult for journalists who become journalists because of a desire to seek and write about truth, to recognize that most of your readers aren't reading you because they're trying to seek truth.
I mean, it's something we've talked about in science journalism, but I was thinking more of some of the work by Dan Kahan at Yale.
Yeah.
In which, mm-hmm. you know, we used to have this theory that if we just continually educated people more about science, they would come to understand how it worked and believe in it more and become, and in fact, that never happened. And Dan Kahan has a really, the cognitive identity where you're protecting your cognitive identity. He has a whole webpage in which he looks at the way that we sort of select from facts. You reminded me, though, something. It was the William James One White Crow. Mm-hmm. The idea that if you want to prove that all crows are not black, mm-hmm. you need only one white crow. Mm-hmm. And his point was just the one fact undoes the everything else. Right, so I do think people selectively go that way. I think you're right.
So with regard to your research and some of this in concert with Kyle Saunders and your student, right, Christina Farhat, is that right? So, really kind of dives into who believes this, but it also, you know, does, as you were kind of hinting at, test whether the propensity to believe in conspiracy theories is ideological in some way. Is it ideological? Is it more likely when you're winning versus when you're losing? Is it some interaction of these things? What are you finding in this work?
So I'll tell this research story, and for a few minutes, just hold Trump aside for a minute. We'd like to hold Trump aside for a lot longer than a minute, but for the time being, when we were starting to do our work on conspiracy theories, we came from a motivated reasoning perspective, and we're arguing that and not surprisingly, I mean, this isn't new, but that Democrats and liberals would endorse certain conspiracy theories, and Republicans, conservatives would endorse others. That wasn't the news. The news was more about the knowledge and trust findings with regard to that. But one of the things that we did find, and this echoes some work of others, was that this motivated reasoning was stronger for Republicans than it was for liberals. And that, in fact, it was the high knowledge, low trust Republicans who were doing this more, endorsing conspiracy theories that make the other side look bad, more than Democrats were doing it. And there is certainly a strain of research that suggests that conservatives are personality-wise predisposed, they're higher in threat sensitivity, they're predisposed maybe to be more likely to latch on to conspiracy theories. But there's an alternative explanation that I've been pursuing in my work and that I have a significant amount of evidence for now, that when I looked back at all the work that I've been doing and others have been doing on conspiracy theories, it's all of the empirical work asking people whether they believe in this new in this era was all during the Obama administration. Okay. Republicans are on the losing side of politics. Okay. Does being on the losing side have any impact on believing in conspiracy theories? And if we go back to the psychology of uncertainty, and if you're on the losing side, if you're least powerful, you're more uncertain, and you're more wanting to explain why you're on the losing side in a way that's not just, well, my side must be wrong. It's that side, the other side cheated.
More comforting.
It's much more comforting to believe that the other side is engaging in all of these underhanded tricks than to believe that maybe my side just isn't right.
Or maybe there was a conspiracy.
Okay,
how many people here think that there was a conspiracy involving the Russians to help elect Donald Trump?
No one's going to admit it now.
Yeah.
No one's going to admit it.
I mean, every liberal in America is a conspiracy theorist right now.
Absolutely. And that's key here. So we did a quick study pre and post election, and we asked a series of questions about general conspiracy beliefs, not ideological. So is the government run by secret people that we'll never understand? A couple of more general questions. And before the election, Republicans were more likely to believe these types of statements. Right after the election, I'm talking 2 or 3 days after the election, the finding flips. Okay. Democrats are more likely to believe them. This is before Trump actually gets into office. This is while Obama is still president. The very fact of Democrats losing that election flipped their beliefs. And this was a panel study, so I'm looking at the same people. Over time. I think being on the losing side plays a bigger role than personality does in these beliefs because of the uncertainty that being on the losing side fosters.
So I have a question, which is, I don't consider the Republicans to be on the losing side. And even when Obama was president, I thought of the GOP as much more successful than the Democrats. If you look across the country, it's in states. Mm-hmm. They're not, I mean, there's a huge majority of Republican governors. If you look at Wisconsin, you can hardly say that the Democrats are on the winning side. Mm-hmm. So are we just saying that because it's the president, the Democrats were winning? Because I don't see that.
It's really interesting. There was a Pew study that was done in December, 2015, that showed that 75% of Republicans thought that on issues that were important to them, their side was losing more often than winning. 54% of Democrats thought so. So both sides thought that they were losing, the majority on both sides did, Republicans thought so more. We had attempted to try to experimentally manipulate perceptions of loser status during the Obama administration, trying to get more Republicans to think that they were on the winning side. And one of the ways we tried to do that is to focus on how many state houses they've won, that all the politics is at the state level, and we couldn't move them.
Interesting.
Well, as the token conservative here, let me just give you a little bit of insight into that, because I think this is an important dynamic to understand what's happening right now. Is, you know, on the right, they have created a perpetual outrage machine, and that a lot of this conservative infrastructure, these organizations, they rely on that constant sense of betrayal and outrage. We are losing all of the time. We're never doing enough. And of course, this is how they raise money. This is how they get clicks. This is how, you know, they get ratings. So it is very interesting that at a time when the Republicans were winning all of these things, we're moving ahead, there was this huge pushback. No, you're being betrayed. You're losing. The problem is that now they are in charge in government. The perpetual outrage machine keeps working. And I think you saw that last week. Why did the Obamacare repeal go down? This was, you know, they've been talking about this for 7 years. This was the most important piece of legislation, and they couldn't get it done. Well, because a lot of the thinking and the brains had been outsourced to this, you know, we are constantly being betrayed. It's never good enough. We are not pure enough. And I think this is going to be a real problem going forward for conservatives, that they don't, they become very comfortable now being outraged and being beset.
I think that's right. When I said hold Trump aside for a minute, that, you know, my work then, well, then what explains Trump? Trump won the election. He's peddling in conspiracy theories all the time now. How, you know, Joanne, how does your work explain that? And I think it's exactly this. As much as for as much talk as much of Trump's talk is about winning, he acts as if he's always losing.
Right.
And it's very much everybody is out to get me.
Right. Okay. Right.
And there are all of these conspiracy theories.
And his supporters like that.
And his supporters.
This is important.
Absolutely.
Is they're all beating up on him. He may be the leader of the free world, but if you look at the numbers, why conservatives rally around, it's because, you know, there are people out there. They're trying to get him all the time.
Yes. And so I think, you know, had Ted Cruz become president, we certainly wouldn't see this level of this. And I think it would probably be easier for me to convince you right now what I truly believe, which is that Democrats and liberals are more conspiratorial now than Republicans are. And I think it, again, because they lost the election, but because Trump is acting as if he's still losing, and his supporters are feeling under siege always, even when they've won, that you're going to see a lot of this still coming from the right.
Don't you think his supporters are still under siege because the kind of things that they wanted to happen are not entirely going to happen? They actually are losing. If I go, you can argue with me about this, but if I went to, say, the West Virginia coal country, I would argue they're still losing, right?
I think that's probably right. And we'll see it because it's really the perceptions that matter here, the perception of whether we're winning or not. And I think we just have to separate Trump supporters from all Republicans too. I think that that's important as well, and not think about Republicans versus Democrats, I think, in this era.
So before we turn this over to some audience questions for our last few minutes, I have kind of just one last question I'd like everybody to take a swing at. You know, it's maybe in some ways been a depressing but engaging 45 minutes. How can we get people to believe the truth? What can scholars do? What can talk show hosts do with big audiences? What can journalists do? How do we get people to believe the truth?
Well, that's the million-dollar question, isn't it? You know, I don't know the answer. I mean, I do think, though, the question's important because this is about truth. This is really not about one party or another party. And one of the people that I've gotten to know pretty well in my new job is Garry Kasparov, the former chess champion, a Russian dissident, who I think understands this better than most Americans. You know, and he actually wrote, he said, you know, the point of modern propaganda, basically fake news, is not only to misinform or push an agenda, it is to exhaust your critical thinking, to annihilate truth. His point is that with all of this out there, that the real danger is not just that people will believe the misinformation, it's that they will give up trying to figure out what's truth. They'll just shrug and say, you know, what is truth? They will surrender, they will tune out, which of course, you know, the great leaders always want. So, you know, the first question is to understand that what we are seeing is really an existential question about truth and the trust for truth. I actually think that in order to break through this pattern, conservatives we're going to have to take the lead on this. The liberal media needs to be as careful as it possibly can, get it right, you know, as much as you can. But at some point, in order to break through all of this, there's going to have to be some folks on the right that will have to police the bad actors on our side. The New York Times' best possible investigative reporting is not going to break through the alternative reality silo. The best academic research in the world is not going to break through. It's only when trusted people, and the trust is the key thing, people say, this is not true, this is false, this is what we have to do. Our movement will not be strong unless we are credible. So I wish I could say that I'm seeing positive things happening. There's a couple of blips here and there, but ultimately, I do think it's gonna have to be people on the right who are gonna have to take a lead on this.
You know, and there is evidence that when that happens, those messages get amplified. When what scholars can wonkily call costly talk, right? When a Republican says, here's where the conservative is wrong, or what a Democrat says, here's where the liberal is wrong, that stuff tends to get reported more, and it tends to be trusted more, because it's coming from that source of trust. And so there's evidence to kind of back up that thought, but I thought you probably had more to say about that.
I was going to say exactly the same thing, that when it's sources for whom it is against their self-interest to say something, they're more credible, and that information is more likely to be believed. So I want to echo what Charlie said, in that conservative talk shows having David Farron hold on, for example, is a perfect example of how to do this. My fear is that folks like Charlie who do this then get put in a box of not real conservatives anymore, right? Rather than, this is a conservative who is speaking truth. And so that's again, because motivated reasoning is so primary. One bit of data, an anecdote here. When in September of last year, when Trump had his press conference and said, Barack Obama was born in the United States, mic drop. By the way, it's because of me that we now know that for sure, but, yeah. Right? It is solved. Barack Obama was born in the United States. Story over. I had done a survey in May, and right after he gave that press conference, I ran to my IRB and said, can we go back and recontact the people that we contacted in May? I know we didn't ask to do that, but can we please do that? And I did, and we recontacted the Republicans from that survey about a week or two after Trump's statement. And we had asked the birther question in the May survey. It turns out that a couple weeks right after Trump made his statement, a significant number of Republicans moved from believing that Barack Obama was not born in the United States to moving towards believing that he was, either becoming from he definitely wasn't born to he probably wasn't born or now I don't know, but they moved in the direction of being more likely to believe that he was born in the United States. So again, a source speaking outside of their interests here can be effective. Now, I don't know how long that lasts because I wasn't able to follow up with them a third time, say in December or January, but we do see a little data anecdote.
Deb?
It's interesting to think of the conservative media and liberal media, but I think...
Can you get a little closer to the mic,
yeah,
please?
I keep doing that. Yeah. But I think one of the most important things that we're going to have to do now as journalists is be very careful when we're doing these stories to get them as right as we can. And I was thinking about that. There was not too long after Trump was elected, there was a Time magazine reporter who was in some Oval Office gathering, and he didn't see a bust of Martin Luther King. Do you remember this?
Absolutely.
Right.
Didn't check
Huge.
It, right? Didn't find out what had happened, just reported that Trump had removed the bust. And so for the next few days, even though there were some fairly serious actions taken by the White House, they just kept coming back and saying, well, but you can't trust the media because, I mean, look at this. This guy made up this story about the Martin. It went on for days. I, as a reporter, if I had seen that guy, I would have slugged him, right? I mean, I really would have. It's like, don't just report something because you don't see a stupid bust. Actually ask someone what happened to the bust if you don't see it. Do basic good journalism, yeah. And it's on us more than it ever was to be.
Damaging.
Yeah, it was terrible. Really careful, really precise, really methodical about getting the information right. And I want to mention briefly, at the magazine that we started, after we hired an editor, our next hire was a fact checker who's actually sitting in this audience. She's a stand-up Jane. She's a University of Wisconsin graduate, Jane
Yay.
Roberts. She's completely terrifying as a fact checker, I can tell you, because she's fact-checked my stuff. But but this is our job, right? Let's not pretend that it's just okay to kind of skate our way through this. If we're going to report it, and we want it to go out beyond whatever our audience is and be repeated outward, then we have to get it right. And I think that's more important than it ever was.
So we have some time for audience questions, and while the microphone gets to those of you who are raising your hands, I'll promote Deb's magazine, Undark. Charlie's forthcoming book, How the Right Lost Its Mind, and note that Professor Miller's Twitter handle is wrong. Not fake news, just an error. P-O-L-I, Sci Prof. So if you're trying to follow her and aren't finding her, the first Y is an I. Questions from?
Hi. Yes, I recently, in the last couple days, the difference between how the House Investigative Committee and the Senate Investigative Committee are functioning has been in the news. And this issue of trust that everyone's been talking about, it seems to me, regardless of how they're functioning or what that actually is, it seems that the public reaction to those two divergent ways of functioning suggests that the bipartisan cooperation model generates a lot more trust. Is there anything analogous, aside from this panel that we're seeing right now, in the world of journalism that talks about people sort of trusting each other as individuals, trusting each other's integrity, and proceeding from that point of view as partners in order to do investigative journalism?
Oh, that is a great question. You know, one of the problems now with Devin Nunes, I think I tweeted out yesterday that I was trying to imagine how he could have handled this any more horribly, and I cannot do it. Every time he opens his mouth, he destroys his credibility. I mean, is there anybody on either side who is really going to believe anything that comes out of the House committee? And that contrast with the Senate was so dramatic, where you had Republicans and Democrats basically say, look, we are going to be working together to find out what is true. That was, I mean, almost the split screen of this is how you be credible, this is how you be incredible. And yes, it's a very, very good model for journalism, because I think, but again, it's, you know, it's harder. How do you do bipartisan journalism? What does that actually mean? I do think it again, I hope, you know, I'm willing to look in the mirror and say, where did I screw up? What did I do? How did I contribute to this problem? I would certainly hope that folks in the media do the same thing, ask themselves those questions, because maybe that is an indication, because you know that the Senate panel is going to be far more believed than the House panel.
You know, I thought after the election there was all of these East Coast, I don't mean to make fun of it, but it just seemed like there were a lot of East Coast reporters who were suddenly parachuting into a hayfield in Kansas and going, oh, look.
They're still doing it. Yeah.
Right? And it just, and so I don't know that bipartisan is what I'm looking for, but I think we have to be a lot smarter and a lot more thoughtful about how we look at the different sides of an argument. It goes back to, again, partly to my false balance example. But I think it's on us, again, as journalists, to weigh credibly what this size is and what it means. And you know, and not just do, you know, disgruntled farmers as supporters of Trump and things like that. I think we need to be much more in-depth and much more thoughtful in the way we write about these subjects.
Many hands are up. Sharon
Dunwoody. Hi, Deb. A question for you. Strikes me that the balanced reporting on climate change is pretty much evaporated and has been. Again, reporters are now speaking from evidentiary bases. I'm curious, in your sense of how that happened, because it's very hard for reporters to get to that stage. And secondly, and this is not a question that I guess either of us could answer, but is that influencing public perceptions of the issue?
That's a great question. Hey, Sharon. So somewhere around, I would say, in the last decade or so, we've been having this ongoing conversation in the community of science journalists, at least, and in the community of journalism, in which it became pretty obvious that there was a rock-solid consensus on climate change. And I do want to say, you know, we talk about facts as being mutable things, but in fact, they're not all, sometimes they're just facts. And I found myself in an argument with someone who said, oh, you know, facts, they're really squishy. I go, really? Because water freezes at 32 degrees Fahrenheit, and you can sit with a bowl at 50 for the rest of your life, and it is never going to turn to ice, right? That is a fact. And the mechanisms of climate change, and like I said, mechanisms matter, are perfectly well established and are actual facts. So at a certain point, and I would put it within the last decade, everyone in my community started saying, well, let's not be dishonest, right? Because if we're actually going to argue that there are two equal sides here, then we're being dishonest with the readers. And that's one of the real problems, not just in science journalism, but I'm going to pick science journalism, is that you start feeling this weight, right? How do I honestly report this science? Here's the scientific consensus. Here's what all the evidence is telling me, right? Do I then pretend that there's a counterbalance to that because of the old political model of, this side and that side? So I'd say it changed in the last 10 years, and one of the most interesting examples of that actually is not in the science writing community, but it's the letter to the editor policy in the LA Times, which was established in 2013. And the editorial page editor at the LA Times said they would no longer accept letters from climate change deniers, period. And there was this huge—
I think that's a horrible idea.
He said, and there was a huge argument about freedom of the press,
mistake.
But what he said is we don't print fiction on this page.
No, you know what? This is exactly the wrong direction. I'm not going to argue with you on this, but
yeah.
but this absolutist, we're not even going to listen to you, we're going to tell you to shut up. This is not going to get us closer to where we need to be. You know, I mean, part of it is, you know, that at least regard people with some respect and listen. That decision by the LA Times was greeted with a great deal of enthusiasm by the people you call the climate change deniers, because it basically says, okay, you know what? Your opinion is not going to be taken seriously. This paper is already chosen sides. If you want to hear the other side, other things, here we are here. If you cede the debate, if journalists say basically, no, this is a closed question, if you want to actually have a discussion about it, you need to go somewhere else. Trust me, there's somebody else that will provide that space.
You know, it's an interesting problem because at one level, you know that human-induced climate change is in fact a reality. And you know, I'll just pick something else, with vaccines, that herd immunity is a reality. Right? So now I'm going to the left and the criticisms of the way we cover things in either case. And so the question is, if you actually know that this machinery of climate change or the machinery of herd immunity is real and in place and matters, how do you report that well, right? And do you... And I go back and forth in the LA Times decision on editors, but do you just acknowledge that people disagree with it, or do you give equal time? And it's the equal time decision that's more interesting. I'm not saying that we shut down the conversation, but I am saying you have to wait what reality is.
So we have lunch coming up. Lunch is not a hoax. It is scheduled for now, but I'm going to use a moderator's prerogative to engage with one more audience question, and then we'll hear very quickly from the Ethics Center Director before you're excused to lunch, but please, sir.
The theme has been struck on, I think, every panel thus far this morning that, okay, it's on us as journalists to do our jobs, be on our game, get everything right, everything has to be airtight. And the response, not just from the right, but elsewhere, is, well, it's about time, where were you up until now? How do we ever get past that? How will we ever get our credibility passed if that's always out there? You can't undo the past.
Yeah, that's a really good question. So, I mean, if you look, and people have talked about history, if you go back and you look at the history of journalism, the book that I'm just finishing now is Right in the Era of Teddy Roosevelt. Teddy Roosevelt, you know, his rant about muckraking journalists who, you know, made up things and only, I mean, this is a long time. What is the actual long-time credibility of journalists, right? I think we just can't let ourselves be weighted down by the past. I think it's okay for us to say, this is a really important time in journalism, which is what I think. I think that, and Charlie might disagree with me, but I think that the mainstream media on the East Coast was way too cozy with power. Right. It hugely influenced the way they covered government. And now I hear people praising the Washington Post, and you know, its new little subtitle, Democracy Dies in Darkness, which I think, you know, we could wait a little while before we got to that point, but I think that this is a great time for journalists to reestablish themselves and to stand up and to do what I think, if we are going to justify the First Amendment protection of journalism, and we're going to argue, as Thomas Jefferson said, that good journalism is essential to a good democracy, then let's be that.
Yeah, I actually completely agree, all of that. And you know, this is that moment where journalists said, okay, well, now we're going to get serious. Well, you do know, as I think your question assumes, that a lot of conservatives looked at it and say, well, so you were sleeping through the last 8 years, you were cozy, right. you had, you know, fawning adoration when you covered certain things, you were not as aggressive, you were not critical, you were not adversarial. You know, sometimes the media act like the palace guard around certain people that they liked or were they favored. And by the way, people saw that and are struck by the irony. But, you know, think long term. I think part of the problem is we always think, you know, in terms of 100 days or, you know, 4 years. You know, going ahead, I completely agree. This can be a renaissance for journalism, realizing that, okay, are you going to be as tough and adversarial the next time there's a Democratic president? Are you going to be as tough and adversarial? Or are you going to allow your partisan, you know, leanings to color? You know, this is one of those moments where a lot of journalists, I think, woke up and said, okay, our job is, you know, to speak truth to power. And by the way, this is going to be fun, and it's going to be cool. Your question is, why didn't they realize that before? Fine, but look ahead. 10, 15 years from now, is that lesson going to stick?
Yes, that's exactly right. Yeah.
And I just want to pick up on something that Charlie that said there, and that journalists are people, too. Journalists engage in motivated reasoning. You're people. And as much as your training is not that, I think that, again, getting back to this, well, okay, so why'd you wake up now? Well, because there was a Democrat in the White House for 8 years. Mm-hmm. And going forward, will you still be this speaking truth to power when there is a Democrat in the White House again? And I think that sort of how do you stop yourself? Again, the bust of Martin Luther King not being in the White House. I mean, it fit with the preconceived notion
right.
of Trump.
The narrative.
So it fit with the narrative, and it was easy to not check it. And of course it's true that it's no longer there. Okay. So, for that journalist.
The thought process.
Sorry, yes.
Not the action.
For the journalist, it is there. But why check that? Because
right.
it fit with the narrative. And I think that being introspective, and I could say this, I'm not a journalist, so I don't want to get preachy here about the profession, but again, reminding yourselves as journalists that you're human and you have the same evolutionary brain that evolved the same way that everybody else's brains has, and checking that in yourselves as you're reporting going forward, I think is going to be very important.
Joanne Miller, Charlie Sykes, right. Deborah Blum, thank you so much for an engaging hour.
Wow, what a morning. I don't know if my brain can just keep soaking it all up. So we are now turning to the lunch portion, and then a really fantastic, fascinating new approach to the ethics conference, with great gratitude to my colleague and affiliated faculty member, Lindsay Palmer. We have a new approach to breaking you out into conversation. So we're gonna start from now until about 1 o'clock with you eating lunch. And then at 1 o'clock, you'll find tables out there. At each table, a person is going to join you who's going to serve as sort of a facilitator of a discussion about issues that maybe we have raised this morning, or maybe we haven't raised this morning. What are some of your concerns? What are your critiques? How do you see yourself represented in news media? How do you not? And then we'll be leading into later this afternoon when my dear friend Jill Geisler will lead our final panel on what's the way forward. You can have some discussion about that as well. So I'm gonna ask our table leaders, before you dash out to get lunch, to just meet Lindsay up here briefly. She just wants to talk with you a little bit, give you a number. Everybody else, there are two tables with two buffet tables with lunch, one out that door, one out that door. Split yourselves evenly, please. And I'm happy to let you know that, you know, Mallory was in the back cooking and dicing things up. So even if you registered on site today, please join us for lunch. And again, thanks to our sponsors for making both free registration and lunch all possible. So again, out both doors, and please find a table.